Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The terrorist attacks in Paris last week have brought out the worst in the Republican Party, and we tell you why these people are ready to launch another war. Marco Rubio is climbing in the Republican polls, but that's mainly because the corporate-controlled media refuses to ask him questions about his past. And we'll bring you the news that the corporate media refuses to cover in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
The mainstream press has been relentless with their attacks on Hillary Clinton over both the Benghazi non-scandal and over her emails. But where's all the coverage of the Republican scandals, specifically the scandal-plagued up-and-comer Marco Rubio? Rubio has some very serious issues that he needs to answer for, but unfortunately, the press isn't asking any of those questions. For more on this, let's go to Eric Bollert, Senior Fellow at Media Matters. So, Eric, obviously the media has made a huge deal about Benghazi, about Hillary Clinton's emails, about what Hillary Clinton had for breakfast on most days. But the Republican candidates, and largely because the media is controlled by corporations who love Republicans, these guys are getting a free pass. And I don't think anybody's been given a bigger pass than Marco Rubio, who has some serious issues in his history of financial misconduct that really need to be looked at, don't they?
Yeah, it's a pretty obvious story. I mean, this is sort of like campaign 101. If you go back to the 80s and the 90s, the aughts, if you ran for president, you know, one of the first things people would do is look at your financial background. How did you earn your money? Did you earn it honestly? And are you beholden to anybody? Were there any kind of shady deals that you only got because you were a politician? Were you spending on other people's money? And with Marco Rubio, for those last two, the answer is yes and yes. I mean, you know, he was a rising star in Republican politics in Florida at a time when the Florida Republican Party was drowning in cash and they were handing out these credit cards. And Rubio started spending them on things like four-day, $10,000 family reunions and pavers for his driveway and things like that. I mean, he was also he was supposed to use it for business expenses and then you pay it back. And that's very normal. But spending it to pay for a family reunion is not normal. And there are lots of other issues about his finances. You know, again, this is sort of campaign 101. If you can't run your own finances, how are you going to run America's finances? And there was some good local reporting in Florida, you know, in 2008, 2009, turn of the decade when, you know, he was a rising star. I mean, at one point, he had $900,000 in debt, three different homes, you know, a large boat. He was leasing, you know, an Audi, $50,000 Audi, and he had a savings of $9,000. So again, I have no idea, you know, where this would all lead, but this is sort of campaign fundamentals. You look into it, and so people have in Florida, not so much nationally, and this all came up because of that first debate or the debate on CNBC. And he was asked about this, and he kind of he turned it into a liberal media bias question, and he said all that stuff had been debunked. Well, none of it's been debunked, and as a few Florida journalists stepped forward and pointed out, this is just absolutely Rubio's story. He's never explained it, and it should be a campaign story.
Right. One of the only things that he said is the fact that, oh, well, that $10,000 I put on the card to pay for this family reunion, I just grabbed the wrong card out of my wallet. I mean, I don't know about you. I've got a couple different credit cards. I have my work credit card in my wallet. I know the difference. They're all different colors. They're different banks. I mean, that is such a BS excuse. But, you know, the national media has bought into it. You know, we're down here in Florida. We've been covering this story since the first St. Petersburg Times stories. Well, it is. And what's really fascinating for us is that this kind of did become a campaign issue during his Senate campaign against Charlie Crist. And he still overcame it in the state of Florida enough to win. Crist was obviously hurt by the independent running for Senate. So Rubio got a little bit of a free pass because he thinks, okay, well, I overcame it in my Senate race. Now I don't have to deal with it anymore. But, you know, thrusting himself into this national presidential spotlight, should we be bringing this back up? I mean, he thinks he's done with it, but is it still an issue?
Yeah, of course it's an issue. You know, to the credit of the New York Times, they have been on this story on and off this year. They did a big story in the spring about his finances, not just the credit cards, about the three houses, about the boats. And if you remember, the Rubio campaign freaked out and they said liberal bias. There was this big kerfuffle about whether the boat he had bought, $80,000 boat, was a luxury boat or not. A lot of the right-wing media attacked, you know, the New York Times, but the bolts of the story are completely solid. And so it was interesting, you know, the Rubio campaign sort of freaked out when a national outlet raised questions about his finances. And then during this CNBC debate, he freaked out again. He refused to answer the questions. He said they've all been discredited. As you know, in Florida, none of them been discredited because he has never addressed them. And then he played the liberal media bias card, and that was the story for the next 2 weeks or so. So the question is, will he be able to scare the press off this story? And as you started in the beginning, I mean, you know, there's only so many times you can play this imagine if, but imagine if Hillary Clinton had, you know, charged her family reunion to a DNC credit card. And then she said, oh, I just reached for the wrong card. And the rest of the DC press said, oh, okay. I mean, the Washington Post actually did a story on how this the Rubio story isn't a scandal. You know, Politico kind of ran out in front, you know, after the debate and said, oh, this is no big deal. It's a big deal if you're going to pretend Hillary Clinton's emails are, you know, select committee important, and if you're going to, you know, demand to know where all her money went.
Well, you know, this is an issue because we have a person who's running for president, but even when he was the Speaker of the House in the state of Florida, he's using his GOP credit card for personal expenses that, you know, maybe he is reimbursed, maybe he is not. The reports don't specifically say if everything has been paid back, but he's going to Apple Computers and buying computer parts. He's getting $200 haircuts. Yeah. You know, he's going to Winn-Dixie. He's going to liquor stores. I mean, those are things that showed up. And then that doesn't even touch the issue of the shadiness that happened when he was selling his house and buying the other house. I mean, there's some real kind of scandalous things going on that he hasn't been clear about. He hasn't been honest about. And the press is not asking questions. I mean, this home buying issue, to me, this seems like a very shady deal with buying the house of a family friend below value, selling his above value. Yeah. It's very, you know, seedy, it looks like to me.
He was able to get a house reevaluated something like 30 days after he just bought it by a friend owned by a friend. He bought this house in Tallahassee to kind of be his home away from home while he was at the state house. Turns out he and his buddy stopped paying mortgage for 5 months because they had a dispute. This is all just, I mean, it's classic example. It seems to be of a young politician just swimming in other people's money. And, you know, and having fun with it. And now being thrust into the national spotlight, probably never thought he'd be where he was today, 8 or 10 years ago, and having to answer these questions and refusing to and trying to get the scare off the press or try to get them to buy into he's explained it all away. But yeah, no, I mean, you know, Florida is fairly, as you know, is known for being pretty fast and loose when it comes to campaign spending and things like that. The Republican Party, they handed out these credit cards. The clear rule was business expenses only. And that's clearly not what he did. And there are some indications he paid it back only after he got caught. So, so the question about the finances and his sort of spin is, the press said Mitt Romney was too rich and now they're saying I'm not rich enough. And, you know, I come from humble means and my father was a bartender and, you know, Democrats are picking on me because I'm not rich like Hillary Clinton. No, they're asking questions because where did you get this money? And again, this is, if you're running for president, you have to be able to explain how you amassed whatever money you have and you, and you know, your transactions should be, transparent. but they're not here. And so as of right now, yes, he's getting away with it. You know, if he emerges next spring, next winter as the front runner on the nominee, it'll come up again. I don't think to its credit, the New York Times, I don't think is just going to drop the story because Rubio hasn't addressed the issues yet.
If we can keep this story out there enough, because these are questions that do have to be answered. It wouldn't matter. Yeah. Even if he was a Democrat, we would still want answers from this. If he was an independent, these have to be answered.
And maybe he has good answers.
Yeah. I mean, if he's paid it all back, if these were legitimate mistakes, come out, say it, put it to bed. That's the end of the issue. But right now, Rubio is doing a fascinating job of, you know, twisting out of these questions, redirecting the conversation to, you know, this liberal media bias. And as long as the rest of the media stays silent on it, he is going to continue to spin out of these attempted tackles and just continue to climb in the Republican Party.
Yeah. And just one last quick point, you know, the Washington Post did this story, a couple weekends ago. They were trying to say, oh, this is no big deal. They did like a 2000 word story about his finances and his credit cards, and never mentioned that he charged a four-day, $10,000 family reunion to his credit. That should be in the first sentence. And Politico, just kind of forgot to mention that. So bad journalism is helping him as well.
Absolutely. Eric Bollert, thank you very much for joining us. We will check back in with you very soon.
All right. Talk to you soon.
Earlier today, Pap and I sat down to talk about the day's biggest news stories that the corporate media refuses to cover. Let's take a look.
You know, Farron, what's happened in light of the Paris attack is we're just kind of reviewing the similarities in a lot of ways that between what happened there and what happened with us on 9/11. One similarity you have to begin with is that the ex-CI director that was there during this period of time in the U.S. during 9/11 said that the White House ignored months of warnings. And now we're hearing a similar story that they ignored weeks of warnings over in Paris. What do you make of all this? I mean, is the system just dysfunctional where it comes to getting information and actually doing anything with it?
Well, I don't know that the system itself is dysfunctional, because the same day of these Paris attacks, we had news reports all over the United States about George Tenet coming out and saying, look, before 9/11, we had been warning the Bush administration for months. We had papers, we had reports, we had a plan about Osama bin Laden wanting to attack somewhere in the United States. And George W. Bush, his response to all of that was, let's put it on the back burner. And now this is before that August presidential daily briefing.
Yeah, August 13th.
Yeah,
August
13th. Yeah, from 2001. Right. All of this was before that. So even before that ignored presidential daily briefing, Bush had all of this information, and his administration was ready to act. At least the CIA and the Department of Defense were ready to act, but they needed his go-ahead. So overall, it may not be the system. I think it just, when you
have... It was
have
the person. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Somebody like Bush who doesn't know any better.
Yeah, well, he knew better. He was a dope. I mean, let's just put it on the table. Bush is a dope. But I don't know that was the case in France. They of course, didn't have that much of a heads up.
Right.
But it still is bothersome, isn't it? That that there are those kinds of, it's just one link in the fence that causes the whole damn thing to fall down. Look, what is your take on the way that the GOP is playing this entire ISIS thing? I don't know that I disagree with you on this, but I do think it at some point, the media and we just have to be not afraid to become a little bit politically incorrect. And what I mean by that is sometimes you just have to say, you know, yes, we did probably create ISIS, but ISIS is here. And now what do we have to do to get rid of it? And it's not going to happen with political correctness. That's what's so bothersome about me in this about hearing this discussion. What's your take on it?
Well, I think right now the Republicans, it's not necessarily a matter of political correctness or who the enemy is. they're just ready to go to war because they've always been ready to go to war. The Monday after the attacks, when the stock markets opened, do you know what happened? Stock prices for weapons manufacturers and big Defense Department contractors went through the roof because these people on Wall Street absolutely knew that we are headed towards a conflict. And conflict for both the media and the defense industry and even the Republican Party is big business, because the Republicans are the ones who get that Defense Department money. CNN, who has been uncharacteristically hawkish about all this, they're the network that people go to for news on war and disasters.
Well,
and
but, so let, but let's take a short step back in time to follow up on your point. The short step back in time is, we remember during the buildup to Iraq, you'd see these huge maps on the floor at CNN and MSNBC, and you'd had these cats walking around, Wolf Blitzer walking around the maps, trying to educate us about where our troops were going to be killed, basically. Trying to tell this story about how we're going to be in and we're going to be out immediately. I see this. I got to tell you something. I see this a little different, Farron. I think that there is a time when you say, we don't know what the long-term ramifications of it might be, but we do know that right now we have this thing called ISIS that you have to take the head off. I don't know how you get around that discussion. I mean, yeah, there is the argument that we've already screwed up, that George Bush and Dick Cheney already screwed up, and they have us here, the invention of ISIS. But we have to be realist about the fact they're invented, and therefore we have to do something. How are you seeing this add up when you review the reports on all of this coming from various blog sites and such?
Well, I don't disagree with you that we have to do something. I think the problem that we're running into right now is that the Republicans are ready to go. I mean, excuse me, they're ready to go. They've got their guns on their backs. They're loading into the pickup trucks, and we're driving over to get ISIS. And that's the problem, because that is exactly what ISIS wants. They want to enact this, grotesque Republican response, to where now we're seeing, like Jeb Bush and Mike Huckabee saying, we're only going to take refugees that are Christian, because that has been ISIS's plan all along, even back as far as 2004 with Osama bin Laden, because they say, look, if we can get the West, the infidels, as they called them, to, come out publicly and denounce us, that leaves our followers with a choice. You either have to side with the infidels or you have to join our ranks. And rhetoric about it is what is so dangerous right now, because they don't want to think, they just want to act.
Rhetoric is always dangerous, okay? I get it. We have the military complex that now is gleeful about all this. I mean, more troops are going to die doing this. They're going to sell more bombs. We're going to take more of our budget and turn it over to Boeing and everybody else who makes a damn bomb. I get that. And I get the fact that we did invent all of this. But I think as this discussion takes place, at least I'm looking at this and I'm saying the reality is that this may be transient. This ISIS thing may be transient, but we have to deal with it.
Right.
And I have a hard time. I have a hard time really looking at this and saying that sometimes you just have to do what may not be politically correct, and you have to talk about things that are not politically correct. I think when the other night when Bill Maher comes out on the show and he starts talking about radical Islam, I mean, my God, you would have thought the guy, that he was some type of Dracula character, some kind of weird beast out there. But he's saying what has to be discussed, and that is, yes, there is a radical Islam, just like there is a radical Christianity. Now, I don't see any problem with that. I don't see any problem with us having a full, frank discussion about what's happening here. if we don't start the discussion, you have idiots like Rick, you know, like Chris Christie and Alabama governor and Bobby Jindal. You have them in Florida saying we don't want to take in. It's not just Syrian. You understand? It's not just Syrian refugees. They're saying we don't want to take your Syrian refugees. But it's really Muslim refugees. That's what this is actually moving to. So without the discussion, without putting it on the table and hearing both sides, even when you have to say some things that people may find politically incorrect, I think it's a problem for what lies ahead here.
Well, I think it's a delicate issue either way. I mean, it's a very ISIS in general. I mean, the way I see it is that it's more of a concept than it is a group or a religion. It's a mindset, and that's what they've gotten into these people's heads over there. And so, to me, the big question is, how do we fight that? How do you fight a mindset? How do you fight a mentality? And the answer is that we absolutely have to do something, but how and what? And unfortunately, those are questions I don't know how to answer, and I'm hoping somebody in the administration knows the way to do it.
Is it different, though, as you're looking at all these reports and you're following all of this material that's coming out of the press, is it different that you have, I mean, Russia is involved in saying, let's go bomb the hell out of them. France, absolutely, they've already started, the bombs have started dropping. That the world community is saying, we can bring about a unified pressure and we can solve this by attrition. I mean, that's really what the discussion is, solve it by attrition. Yes, it is a concept. It's an idea. It certainly is not indicative of Muslim religion. It is indicative of radical Islam, though. And so the question is, where does it land if you take those steps? I want to continue this discussion, obviously, as this story continues to develop. But I don't think there's any easy answer there.
Right.
But I do think that we really do ourselves a disservice if we aren't really willing to sometimes say things that may sound a little bit politically incorrect. I mean, I applaud Bill Maher for doing that. And the idea that he's under such criticism for doing that, I think, is absurd. Donald Trump, while we're talking about absurd, Donald Trump, Trump the Grump, goes on an epic rant slamming GOP candidates and slamming the American people about how stupid we are. I mean, that's his message. We're just too stupid for Donald Trump. What's your take?
Well, the fact that he's still number one in the polls, it kind of does show that, yeah, we might be too stupid, or at least the Republican people being polled are too stupid to understand democracy. I mean, Donald Trump, we've been waiting for a meltdown like this since the day he announced his candidacy. Based on his personality, everything we've seen from him publicly since he started his little apprentice TV show, we knew this was coming. We knew that he couldn't hold back that rage and that bully mentality and the I'm better than all of you mindset that he has. And so this is just what we've all been waiting for, him to come out and publicly talk bad about the Democrats, the voting public, the people in Iowa who are going to hold the first caucus there.
Well, what I'm seeing here is I'm seeing that he's sensing something. I mean, look, he's out, we need to go bomb Syria, take the oil fields, they're scum, they're garbage. The bomb mode has been almost nonstop with Trump. Now, like it or not, you don't do those things unless there's some indication that it might have some appeal. He's moved ahead of Carson. Okay, he's moved ahead of Carson. Carson is a dead man walking, and he simply doesn't know it. So as I'm looking at these stories, I'm kind of trying to analyze them a little bit different from just what's on the surface of the story. You can bet he has good analytics behind him. And what he's doing is, you and I remember talking about months ago, we said when he came out on the border issues, that what he was appealing to was that trying to put visions in people's head about, you know, drug cartels coming to the U.S., students being beheaded, journalists being murdered, police being just outgunned. Those were the images that he was trying to put in into his low-hanging fruit follower heads. So if you remember, it all bounced off of what happened in California, young woman murdered by an Hispanic. Now he's starting that same thing here all over again. Because I really do believe, Farron, I really do believe in that he knows that it is moving votes. People may not admit it. They may not admit, yeah, I'm mad as hell too. I'm going to go bomb the crap out of somebody and wipe out the Syrians and Muslims or whatever it takes. That's his speech. And they may not want to say I agree with him, but I'd be interested to see what happens at the polls.
Well, what's interesting is that Trump's weakest point within the Republican Party itself has always been on the religious right front. But now he is able to adopt this mantle of we have to go kill the Muslims to protect the Christians. And that could be enough to at least swing some of those voters away from Huckabee and Ted Cruz over to Donald Trump's camp to keep him at the top through the first few sets of primaries and caucuses, because that's really all he's going to need.
Isn't it about attrition here, Farron? I think you've done a story. You and I have talked about this idea. Isn't it the last man standing with the Republicans? I mean, in other words, if Jindal falls by the side and he only has 2%, well, Trump's counting on picking up that 2%. Yeah. If Huckleberry falls to the side, well, he's thinking about picking up Huckleberry's 4%. And then all of that adds up in the end, I think, is your position on this. And I think that is kind of what Trump's looking at. But while he's doing it, he's understanding a lot about the metrics here. I just have a very tough time believing that he doesn't believe what we're talking about. And that is, you know, the voter out there may say, oh, man, that's horrible talk. But when they go back in that voting booth, they are afraid of cabals and they are afraid of cartels coming across the border. They are afraid of Syrians living in their backyard. And so that's what he's appealing to. I think his people are probably telling him it's pretty smart.
Well, I'm sure they are, because for Trump's campaign, for any Republican campaign, that is a good move. And one thing about Donald Trump, I mean, you know, he's had a string of business failures, obviously, but and he's, you know, he's got some demons kicking around in that head of his, but he's not completely stupid. He does know how to read people, and he certainly knows how to read polls. And so that's what he's doing right now, is he's seeing, essentially, it's you're throwing the spaghetti against the wall to see what sticks. And he knows what sticks with them. He knew that this immigration tirade that he kicked off his campaign with was going to work. And now he can take it even further because he's using Paris to bolster his position on it, and it works for him.
In about a minute, you know, GOP's in panic. They're floating another idea of Romney running. That they see a train wreck here, and they should. So Romney is not saying no. You know, Romney is still out there possibly floating this idea, and it may be the only chance for Romney to ever really be elected president, but he's playing this pretty smart. What's your take in about 40 seconds?
If I'm Mitt Romney, I'm looking at the Republican Party right now and saying, you know what? Go to hell. You had your chance. I did my best, but I apparently did so bad for you that after my loss, you had to go through this whole autopsy report to find out how bad I was. But that's what the Republican Party is doing. They're not learning from the mistake. They're trying to go back and say, let's go back to the point where we were only horrible instead of horribly terrible.
Think about how smart Romney and Huntsman look. What electable candidates they look like now compared to these fools that have been parading around for the last few months. Farron Cousins, thank you for joining me. News never stops, does it?
No, it does not. Thank you.
And that's all the time we have for tonight. But you can get more Ring of Fire on our website at ringofireradio.com. And you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.